not even profound. In fact, it's quite possibly the most elementary thing that you will ever learn about Christianity. But at the same time, it's possibly the most important thing you will ever learn about Christianity. That's what I love about God, and what I love about our faith is the fact that it's so profound and so complex that you can study it for your entire life and never get a full understanding or a mastery of it. But yet at the same time, it's so simple that even a child can understand it. And God is just amazing that way. And tonight, I want to cover what I consider to be the most elementary yet the most important aspect of our faith. And with that, let's turn to John chapter 8 and jump right in. Jesus had been teaching in the treasury of the temple, and he had shared with the people who he was. He had told them where he was from. He had explained to them their sin. He had explained to them that their rejection of him would cause them to die in their sin. And the Bible says that in the process of talking to these people, that many believed on him. In other words, many heard what he said and said, you know what, I believe that. And as a result, gave their faith and placed their faith in him as their Savior, as their Messiah, as the one who was going to cleanse them and remove their sins from them. And then, in verse 31 of John chapter 8, he says this. Then Jesus said to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Heavenly Father, tonight I pray with earnest that Father God, your Spirit would just plant this truth into our hearts. That, Father God, you would help us to see what your death on the cross really purchased for us. That you would help us to see, Father God, that there is a freedom that's set before us that we are able to walk in. That, Father God, you would help us to see the fullness of what you've done on the cross. And, Father God, may we walk out of this place changed with a new attitude and with a new understanding. And, Father God, with a new purpose in life. Father God, most of all, that you would be glorified by everything that we say and do, so that others would come to know of this same gift that you've given us. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Jesus says, the truth shall make you free. And the question is, free from what? Free from what? And that's the exact question that the Jews had, because in John chapter 8, verse 33 and 34, it says, they answered him and said, we be Abraham's seed, and we were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou that you shall make us free? And Jesus answered them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whomsoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. For years and years and years, Christians, myself included, the church has preached forgiveness. And we have placed the idea of forgiveness as the focal point of Christianity. We share the message of forgiveness, that what Jesus did on the cross was forgive our sins. He covered our sins with his blood. He cast it as far as the east is from the west. And forgiveness has become the central message of Christianity. And while he did give us forgiveness, and while that is an integral part of what we do and the gift that he's given us, would you be offended tonight if I was to tell you that forgiveness is really not the central theme of Christianity? Forgiveness is not why Jesus died for you and I. Jesus did not shed his blood just to give us forgiveness. He shed his blood to give us freedom. Freedom. Christianity, the central message of Christianity is not forgiveness, it is freedom. It is not forgiveness from sin. sin, it is freedom from sin. That is what Jesus Christ has given us as Christians. And we need to come to understand that tonight. We have got to understand that sin does not have to rule your life any longer. We have got to come to the place where we realize that sin does not control us. Because Jesus died to give us freedom from sin. Christ died to give us power over sin. He says, I have come to make you free. You shall be free from sin. Not just forgiven, but free. As Christians, we are to be Christ-like. And Christ walked free from sin. As Christians, we are to walk as He walked. And though He was tempted like us in all points, it says, yet He was without sin. That means even when the enemy brought temptation to Him, there was something about Him and something within Him that allowed Him to look at the enemy and say, no thank you. There was something that allowed Him to go, I'm not even falling for that. There is something about the life of Christ. He walked free from sin. Not us. Typically, the typical Christian life is, I'm going to try not to do wrong. I'm going to continue living my life. I'm living my life and, oh, I sinned. But I can go and I can ask for forgiveness because Jesus died on the cross to give me forgiveness. And then if I sin again, then I can go to the cross and Jesus forgave me. And if I sin again, then I can... And all of that is true. That is true. Jesus will forgive us no matter how many times we fail. He will forgive us no matter what we do. He will forgive us no matter how many times we sin against Him. But more so than forgiving us, He would much rather see us walk in freedom from the sin. He says to obey is better than sacrifice. In other words, it's much better for us just to walk free of the sin than to have to ask for forgiveness. And even though He will forgive us, that is not the reason that He died. He did not die just to continuously cover our sin. He died to set us free from sin. And we need to understand that tonight. 1 John, in his book, he writes to us and he says in chapter 3, verse 6, basically he says, whoever is a Christian does not sin. And that those who do sin are of the devil. That's what John writes in his book. Peter, in 1 Peter 2:11, says that we are to abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul. We're to stay away from that stuff. Paul tells us to put off the old man. In other words, I take off that man, that flesh, that thing that constantly drug me into sin. I'm to take that off. And I'm to put on a new man. And that's what we need to do. Christ came to destroy the works of the enemy, not just forgive us when we do them. Jesus destroyed them. When we become Christians, we are to consider ourselves dead to sin. That's what the Bible says. Consider yourself dead to sin. What does that mean? It means if you were to go to the funeral home right now and you were to walk in and walk up to the casket and maybe there was the biggest drunk that you'd ever seen in your life, lived intoxicated 24/7, and you were to take him his favorite beverage and set it right in front of him, I can guarantee you that he's not tempted because he's dead. You can take the biggest crack addict and you can put the biggest rock you can find and he won't move. He's not tempted because he's dead. Paul says we are to consider ourselves dead to sin so that when the enemy comes and he goes, hey, doesn't this look nice? Blank stare, not even tempted. That's what Christ came to give us, was freedom from that sin. We are to consider ourselves dead. He says, if we're dead, then how can we continue to live in sin? He says, when you were baptized, You were proclaiming the truth that we have died to sin. He says, just as Christ died. He said, when you go through the process or the ceremony of baptism, not that the process or the ceremony does anything for you spiritually, but what it does is it's a symbol, it's a sign, it lets people know that I have died to myself. That old man who was constantly tempted, that old man who was constantly in the flesh, that old man has died and has been buried with Christ. And now that I'm risen again, I rise in a newness of life. One that is now free from that old life, free from that temptation, free from all of those things that used to try to bind me. I am now dead to those things. And now I can live in a newness of life. I can have an abundant life that Jesus talked about, that He wants to give me. Not because He's going to keep forgiving me, but because in the process of that newness of life, I have freedom from sin. Amen. Not just forgiveness. Turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 6. Paul was trying to communicate this same truth to the Roman church. He too realized that they were focused on forgiveness. And we all like forgiveness because it always makes us warm and fuzzy. The idea that God will forgive us, it's a great feeling. And the first time you ask Christ into your life, it's like a weight lifted off of you. Because forgiveness is an integral part of your salvation experience. But for so many years, that's where we've stopped. Teaching people that God will forgive you. And He will. But He will also free you from sin. So that you don't have to keep coming back for forgiveness. But you can walk free of it. That's what God's done for us. Romans chapter 6, verse 11. And I'm going to read quite a bit. So try to focus with me and stay with me. I put it on the screen. So hopefully you can follow along. He says, likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you. For you are not under the law, but under grace. Let's pause there. Here's what he's saying. Do you realize that the Old Testament law, the only reason it was there was to show you how sinful you are? That's why it was there. A bunch of rules, a list of rules to follow, just so you would realize that you can't do it. That's what it's for. And every time God would say, thou shall not, every time you did it, it brought condemnation, it brought sin into you, into your life, because you couldn't do it. Every time He said, you will do this, and you did not do it, it brought sin into your life. Sin is there. But Paul says, but there's this thing that's called grace that Christ has offered us. And because of that, sin has been forgiven. That's the important part. Sin has been forgiven. But he goes on. And he says, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Just because I can find forgiveness, does that mean I should just go ahead and keep sinning? God forbid. He says, God forbid. That's not what I mean. That's not what I'm saying. He says, God forbid, know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are, to whom you obey, whether sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness? He says, don't you realize that you are a servant to someone? You are either a servant to sin or you are a servant to righteousness. Whichever you choose to do, you have a choice in the matter. You have a choice to decide, am I going to live free of sin or am I going to live in it? Knowing that grace abounds, knowing that God can forgive me, But don't keep living that way, because that's not the purpose of His death to begin with. His purpose was to give us freedom from sin. He said, "But God be thanked that you were servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered to you. Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye have yielded your members servants to uncleanliness and to iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness." Just like when you lived that old life and you allowed yourself to sin, now you can make that same choice to live in righteousness. God has freed you. He said, now that you've been freed from sin, when you were over here, when you were living in the world, you were shackled by sin. It controlled you, it reigned over you, and you really had no choice. It was your master. It was the slave driver to your life, commanding you to do what it said. Jesus said, when I died on the cross, I purchased you. I redeemed you. That goes back to Old Testament, when basically somebody said, you know what? That person doesn't need to be there. But this person owed a debt that they couldn't pay. And as a result, that person could only be set free if someone was willing to redeem them. A family member, a friend, would come along, pull out their stash of cash, deal out as much as they owed, paid it forward, and redeemed them. Then that person who was a slave could then be set free. Jesus said, that's what I've done for you. You are a slave to sin. And my death on the cross not only forgave you, it freed you from sin. And now you have been purchased away. I have redeemed you and I have set you free from sin. So now don't keep working for Him. Walk in the freeness that I've given you. Live out the abundant life that I've given you. I did not purchase you from the enemy so that you could continue working for him. I did not die so that you could continue living in the same filth that I rescued you from. I did not deliver you just so you could keep doing the same thing. I will forgive you, but I want you to walk free. That's why I died for you. That's the message of Christ. Not just forgiveness, but freedom. He says, what fruit had ye in those things whereof you are now ashamed? What was so great about that, that you want to keep going back to it? Well, I just can't help it. Yes, you can. You've been freed from that. But you don't know the addiction that keeps dragging me back to it. Yes, there is an addiction. There is a thing that keeps dragging you back. But Christ has set you free. He has set you free. And you don't have to keep going back to it. You can choose to walk in newness of life. Before you had no choice. Now you have a choice. I talk to people all the time and they say, I don't want to be a Christian. I don't want to go to church. There's too many rules. I feel bogged down. I feel like somebody's always trying to keep me down. I can't be free in the church. And I remember telling this one guy, I was like, you know what? You don't even know what you're talking about. I said, do you realize that in the church, as a Christian, I'm more free than you are? He said, yeah, but you can't smoke. You can't drink. I said, yes, I could. I could if I wanted to. You can't cuss, you can't do this. I said, yeah, sure I could. If that's what I wanted to do, I would. I said, I'm more free than you are. He said, that don't make sense. I said, I tell you what, you stop cussing for 2 days. Stop cussing for 2 days. He couldn't. He's not free. Quit smoking for 2 days. Can't. Why? Because you're not as free as you think you are. That's the lie of the enemy. I make you think that you're free. I make you feel like you're free because I can do whatever I want. I can do whatever I want too. I can choose to live free. You can't. You can't without Jesus Christ. He says, What did you have? What fruit did you have in those things that which now you're ashamed of? For the end of those things is death. But now being made free from sin, become servants to God. And have your fruit unto holiness and even everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Eternal life. And here's the thing that blew my mind as I was reading through this tonight and preparing for this message. Most of us think eternal life and we think the life beyond. Do you realize that in order for it to be eternal, it starts now? The moment you realize, it starts now. Your eternal life starts the moment that you accept Christ into your life. And it goes on for eternity, but it's not like a layaway program where I got to wait until I die to have it. It is now. It's not being forgiven that makes you a Christian. It's the life that you live out after you've been forgiven that makes you a real Christian. Does this mean that we have to be perfect? It means you should strive for perfection. Does it mean that if we mess up, we're done? It means if you mess up and you don't make it right, you're done. Does it mean that we're unable to sin? It means that it should be even more and more difficult for the enemy to trip you up as you mature in Christ. Allow me to pause for a moment and clarify another misconception regarding this freedom from sin. Let's go back to our original text for a moment. And Jesus said, "The truth shall make you free." And I must admit, I have preached this, I have taught this, and I apologize to everybody that I have ever misled. Because I have taught and preached that He shall make you free. As if it is a future tense. As if it's a process that you have to go through in order to be free. And it seems that way on the surface. Because there is a sanctifying process that goes along with your salvation. And it is a process. But the freedom is not the process. The work of Christ, as He hung on the cross, He said, "It is finished." It's a completed work right now. You are free now. I've died for you. The price has been paid. It's done. It's over. You are free now. Now you are free. So what's the process, not the freeing? The process is the other part of the verse. Because the other part of the verse says, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." The process is knowing the truth. That's the process. You are already free, but as you discover the truth of your freedom, you become free. You walk in the freedom as you discover it in your life. Jesus already paid the price. It's done. It's finished. You are free. Because those that He has freed are free indeed. That means they are free now. It's not a process where I have to walk a little while and maybe this chain falls off and I'll walk a little bit further and maybe this chain falls off and I'll walk a little further and as I look behind me, there's all these chains that have fallen off. I've preached that message. And again, I'm sorry. Because now I realize the chains fell off here. Every chain fell off here. You're free. But the process is when we walk it out and as we get to know the truth about that freedom, I realize that how free I am. I realize all of a sudden that the chains have fallen off. It's kind of like an elephant. When an elephant is young, The way they train them is they take a young elephant and they'll tie a rope around his leg and they take a stake and they drive it into the ground. And that young elephant pulls and pulls and pulls against that stake, but he can't pull it out. He's too weak. As he grows, he could easily pull it out. But he doesn't know that. And as a result, a piece of string and a wooden stake in the ground keeps him from going anywhere. That's how it is with us. Even though there's really nothing holding us, there's nothing tying us to that old life, sometimes we just have to become aware of it. We have to know the truth. And as we know the truth, we realize the freedom that He's already given us. That's what Christ did. It's finished. The price is paid. He has already destroyed the works of the enemy. It's not a process that I have to go through. It's already done. But I have to know the truth. The process is not the freeing. The process is discovering the truth. So what's truth? Well, we know that Jesus said, "Thy word is truth." We know that Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." But in context of John chapter 8, a few verses before where we started, he says, "The one who sent me is truth." And in context, then, we can realize that the truth that he's talking about is the one who sent him, the Father himself. It says, "You shall know the truth." As we discover who God is, as we discover what He's done for us, as we begin to discover all these great things, as we discover the freedom that He has given us, as we come to know Him, you realize the freedom that He's given you. That's Christianity. To realize that I don't have to keep going back to that mess. I don't have to keep going back to that stuff. I'm free from it. And when the enemy comes and tries to tempt me, I don't have to fall for it. I don't have to allow him to drag me back into it. I don't have to allow addiction. I don't have to allow my flesh. I don't have to allow any of that stuff to pull me away from the abundant life that he gives. That's the process. As I close, I want to return to our opening text. Jesus said, "If you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth." See, that's how you come to know the truth, is by abiding in his word, continuing in his word. We're living in a culture and in a society that doesn't care about his word. God is no longer defined by the word, but instead it's defined by our feelings. It's defined by our wants and what we wish God was like. But do you realize that when we do that, all we're doing is creating an idol made after our own image? A God that we create. And that kind of God, no matter how much you know about Him, is still a lie. You have got to know the truth, the One. And Jesus said the only way to do that is to abide in my word. He said, because the things that I speak are not of myself, but they come from the Father. The things that He did, He said, I do nothing in and of myself, but what the Father tells me to do. The Bible, Christianity, the holy book, our scripture, is for one purpose and one purpose only, and that is for God to reveal Himself to us so that we can come to know Him and who He is and what He's done for each of us. He says, and once you know that, once you know who He is, then you will realize exactly how free you are. That's Christianity. That's why Jesus died on the cross. Make you free not just forgiven.